Good morning.
Good morning.
Blessed and glorious in the sight of God is the death of his saints. That's what the psalmist writes to us, and I believe that is true. While it's sad for us to see one of God's saints leave us and leave our lives because of the hole that her absence will provide in our lives. At the same time, from God's perspective, one whom he loves so dearly has now returned home. The one who's been physically absent from his presence is now in his presence. And so that's why we gather to remember and to celebrate the life of Betty Walters, your loved one. And in her absence from your life, yet she is present with God's. I would remind you that of the words of Scripture, how Jesus said, "For God did not send his own Son into the world, but to be the Savior of the world. That God so loved the world that he sent the Son, that whosoever should believe in him, they shall have life." Remember how that child, when he grew to be an adult, at the death of one of his friends, Lazarus, did say to his sisters, "I am the resurrection and the life. Whosoever believeth on me, though they may die, yet shall they live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die." That is the hope. That is the promise. I hope that you can embrace that promise for yourself as you say goodbye to Betty's physical presence with you. Because I found in my life that Jesus has never lied, and I can trust fully the promises that he speaks to me in life. Would you join me in our opening hymn, "Precious Lord, Take My Hand"? You'll find it in your hymnal on number 474. God, please be seated. Comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to them and to proclaim to them that their hard service has been completed. Their sin has been paid for. See, the sovereign Lord comes with power, and his arm rules for him. See, his reward is with him, and his recompense accompanies him. He tends his flock like a shepherd. He gathers the lambs in his arms and carries them close to his heart. He gently leads those who have young. Who has measured the waters in the hollow of his hand, or with the breadth of his hand marked off the heavens? Who has held the dust of the earth in a basket, or weighed the mountains on the scales and the hills in a balance? Who can fathom the spirit of the Lord, or instruct the Lord as his counselor? Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power to the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who place their hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. Would you pray with me? Gracious, loving God, we come to this time. We come to this place set apart to worship you, because you are truly the Lord of all creation. We thank you that every gift that we know of in life, every blessing that we've received, is from your hand. And one of those blessings that this family and the greater community has received is the life of Betty Walters. Oh, how good you are. You have taken her from us, but yet she remains with us. Even as our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ was taken from us, yet he rose from the grave, remains with us yet because he has given us his Spirit. May we sense in these hallowed moments Spirit not only of our living Savior and Lord, but may we sense even now Betty's spirit and be comforted by her presence. For while we do not see her now, nor do we see Jesus, yet it is only this life that prevents us from seeing them fully. And we look forward to that day when we all will inevitably return and embrace both Betty and our Lord face to face. This is your promise, and your promise is ever true. In this life, we know blessing and curse. In our worship, magnify the blessings of this life and remove the curses that approach and encroach themselves upon us. Come near and be our shepherd in life, for we acknowledge you as our true shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd. I lack for nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes and renews my soul. He guides me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And even though I might walk through the darkest valley, even the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies, and you anoint my head with oil. my cup, the cup of my life, overflows. Surely, your goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Let me share with you a few words from Paul's letter to the church at Rome. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and death. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also through his Spirit that dwells in you. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God, and if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if in fact we suffer with him, so that we may also be glorified with him. I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory about to be revealed to us. We know that all things work together for good for those who love God, who are called according to God's purpose. What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not withhold his own son, but gave him up for all of us, will he not with him also give us everything else? Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I'm convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. And to conclude our thoughts with Scripture today, I turn to the Gospel of John, to these very familiar words that give us so much comfort on a day like this. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, and I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going. I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. In a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. I have said these things to you while I am still with you. But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. Today is a day that we all know will come, but we all live most of the time as if it never will. Death is not a pleasant topic, and our world does everything to prevent it from happening, and so we begin to trust that medical advances will encourage us to be able to live a long time, longer than we could imagine. But today, as we face this reality, Let us take some time to remember the best parts of Betty's life, which are numerous. Her favorite part of her life was her family. She loved to point out the gallery of family pictures she had in her home. She delighted in looking at them and sharing them with others. There were so many wonderful memories the pictures represented. She loved telling the latest story, sharing a picture of the newest addition to the family, or talking about all that you meant to her. She loved being the mother of Linda, Donna, Lee, and George. And Donna's death was an especially difficult moment for her. Then there were her grandchildren, all of you, Ryan, Jeff, Matthew, Catherine, Lindsay, Heather, Sarah, Sydney, and Brooke. And then there were the newest additions to her family, her great-grandchildren, Alyssa, Adriana, Alexandria, Allison, Jace, Mike Jr., and Luca. All of this was a part of her in so many ways and sustained her and encouraged her. I found another important aspect of her life was her creativity. She loved knitting, and she did it quite well, as I'm sure most of you probably have evidence of that around your house. When I arrived at Kirkville in 2011, there was a knitting group that met regularly here. One of their purposes was to create stuffed animals and toys that could be taken to the Golisano Children's Hospital at Upstate Medical Center. Betty loved being a part of that group and creating new stuffed toys along the way, and often would bring in her new projects that she had completed to show all of us at church. I am convinced if the children enjoyed them half as much as Betty did making them, the result was a monumental success. But her gift didn't stay there. You may not know that after she moved to the Village Square Apartments in Manoa, some of the residents at Manoa Estates across Edgerton's Drive were looking to find a new hobby. I'm not sure how, but someone learned of Betty's abilities, and she was soon teaching these neighbors the joy of knitting. I have a very close friend who was part of that group. And they so enjoyed her efforts to bring them that joy, but most of all, they just enjoyed Betty. She was just such a delight. That doesn't sound like much to celebrate, but if we spend time thinking about it, it truly is. And that is the life we have come to recognize and to celebrate. Betty's life was a celebration. Everything she did was to celebrate the gift of life she was given by God. Today, we want to sense God's presence in the midst of these circumstances, of these many blessings, but also in the struggles. To discover the things we can know, let us look at some of the scriptures that often offer us some similar perspectives that Betty lived by. From the book of Ecclesiastes, we read about the difficulties of life. For everything, there is a season, a time for every purpose under heaven, a time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, and a time to pluck up what is planted, a time to kill, and a time to heal, a time to break down, and a time to build up, a time to weep, and a time to laugh, a time to mourn, and a time to dance. Betty was well aware of this reality. She had grown up in difficult times, a child of the Depression, as others of her generation did. Yet as the preacher concludes this section of these opposites, he makes a statement that could be described as Betty's attitude toward all of life. God makes everything beautiful for its time. Despite difficulties, life still has many riches. Betty often spoke of the move of her family to Kirkville when she was a very young woman, young child. She saw that as one of the defining moments of her life. Moving next door to this church, which became such a vital part of her life, was just a story that we heard many times and we delighted in. In her adult life, she faced struggles, but they all led her, as she understood it, to a better life. Her constant statement to me was, "I don't know how God has any time for anyone else, because God takes such good care of me all the time." That belief was a lifelong understanding of God for Betty, and she lived it. She knew that God was always with her. She believed that our precious Lord had taken her hand and led her each day. Her life was guided by God, upheld by God, sustained by God. The next thing we can know comes from Psalm 92. It is good to give thanks to the Lord, to sing praises to your name, O Most High, to declare your steadfast love in the morning and your faithfulness by night. If God makes all things beautiful, if all things work together for good, then we should give thanks to God for this wonderful reality. Betty shared that understanding throughout her life. In her room, you could have read the following statement: in the happy moments, praise God. In the difficult moments, seek God. In the quiet moments, worship God. In the painful moments, trust God. In every moment, thank God. The third thing we know is a promise that Jesus made to us that I just shared from John. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. We can take delight that Betty, through her faith in Jesus, has moved to that new place. She has gone for her are the sacrifices of life. Gone are the pains and struggles that were daily faced. Now she lives in the fullness of God's love with a clear mind, and no pain at all. And finally, the fourth thing we can affirm today are the words of hope expressed in Isaiah. Those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. The promise for those who wait upon the Lord is to mount up with wings like eagles, to run and not be weary, to walk and not faint. Betty is soaring with the eagles now. She is running and not tired at all. She is walking and not fainting. Now she has been made whole in the power and strength of God's promise. We too can know that life is filled with struggles, and yet God makes everything beautiful for our time. We can know that we can give thanks for life, that God's giving is always present. We know that there is a place for us prepared by Jesus, particularly for us. And finally, we know that those who are God's people who believe in Christ are given the new life we all seek. And we will share with these loved ones who have gone before us. We too can rest assured in the eternal care of God's love. The following reading by Annie J. Flint are a fit closing to express Betty's faith and our joy in the moment of her life. God giveth more grace when the burdens grow greater. God sendeth more strength when the labors increase. To added affliction, God addeth great mercy. To multiplied trials, God's multiplied peace. When we have exhausted our store of endurance, when our strength has failed ere the day is half done, when we reach the end of our hidden resources, our God's full giving has only begun. God's love knows no limit, God's mercy no measure, God's power no boundary known unto us. For out of God's infinite riches in Jesus, God giveth and giveth and giveth. Part of our service is the opportunity to share those remembrances, those memories, those special times that you all shared with Betty. And I know her sons are looking to do some of that, and I hope that maybe some of you others would as well. So I will sit down and let you just share the words now that you wanted to share.
thank you everyone for coming today. Mom simply just loved life. It was simple as that. She was very grateful for life every step of the way. She would often say, "Can you believe how lucky I am?" She would tell the story of moving from Skinny Atlas to Kirkville, chasing after my dad, and finally catching him. She said, "Can you believe how lucky that is? How lucky is that?" she would say. Mom and Dad had many great years together, and I know she was grateful for all of them and all the many things they had done. After Dad passed away, Mom found a nice little apartment in Manoa, and she would then again say, "Can you believe how lucky I am to have found this little apartment? It's so perfect. My friend Herb lives behind me. I'm meeting great people all around. Can you believe it?" she would constantly say, "Can you believe it?" After some years at the apartment, Mom was starting to forget things more and more. We decided probably she shouldn't drive anymore. At this time, I started to bring her to get groceries every week or so. And almost every week or so when I would stop, she would say, "You got to come in here and see this. This is unbelievable. You got to see this. Can you believe all this yarn the church gave me to knit these mittens? I just can't believe it. I'm so lucky. How lucky is that?" So she was really the most grateful person I've ever known. She thought she was the luckiest, but it was really her family and friends who were the real lucky ones. When we were choosing the day to have this service, we were going through the days of the week which we would come here. Monday wasn't good for Sheps in the church. Friday I didn't think was very good. Wednesday wasn't really good for my brother Lee. So it came down to Tuesday or Thursday. And we thought, well, let's look at the weather. And we chose Tuesday. When we got home, we realized the date of Tuesday, and it was luck again. It's my dad's birthday. So happy birthday, Dad. The luck continues. Mom lived a long 92 years, and only the last few were kind of sad. And that's not bad for as many as she was here. I'd like to thank everyone who helped us get through these harder years. Ray has been a big help. My sister Linda has been tremendous in all of her efforts, phone calls, and all the medical situations she had to work through. So I want to thank both you guys for all your love to Mom. And Mom used to kid around a lot and say, "Can you believe how much Linda's done for me? I'm so lucky. I'm glad I didn't kill her when she was a teenager." So, thank you all.
My Aunt Patty was one of a kind. I grew even closer to her when my mom and dad both were getting sick, and as my mom passed, I spent more time with her. I would go over and see her. She kind of filled the void when I used to go see my mom. And everything that was already said is true. She'd walk you into the room and show you all the yarn for making the mittens. Always thinking how lucky she was that everybody gave her that yarn, but how lucky are the people that could receive these mittens? I remember, and I shared the video, she was 88 years old. My brother and I had were playing in our playoff match at the golf course, and she loved her golf. And I can't even remember who went and picked her up, but somebody went and picked her up and brought her out to the golf course, and she rode in the cart with me when we were in our final match. We got off the second hole, and we get to the third hole, and she said, boy, I'd love to swing that club again. So I said to the guy we were playing, do you think she could swing off of that tee for just one shot? He goes, sure, let her. So 88 years old, she gets up to the tee, and she knocks it straight down the middle. She knew what she was doing. And I remember countless times when she would say about how lucky she was with the kids. She'd call me around every Christmas, ask me to come up and play Santa Claus and at the family Christmas parties. And that was her thing. She wanted to have that party. She wanted to make sure the kids eat. And even after the party moved to Georgia, she wanted to make sure it still happened down there. When my mom was dying in the nursing home and she came in for the last time, I remember just what George said. They both looked at each other and said, it's a good thing we didn't kill those kids when we wanted to. And just so many times I just remember, and I got two sets of these mittens. One pair I wore, this pair I kept for this day. I'm going to miss her. I don't miss who she was the last couple of years because it wasn't her. I just remember when she was in that apartment in Manoa and she said, boy, up here is going, but I still got it here. She'd click her heels together. You know, and one of the things we learned when my dad had this same terrible disease is that parts of your body die before other parts of your body. And that's truly the only way you can explain what's happened and what keeps happening. But with that said, she loved her family. She loved you guys. No one any more than the other one. And you're going to miss her, but she's going to be greeted by a whole bunch of people. And you know what? She ain't wearing any stupid mask anymore either. And this, hopefully there's no disease up there, and I can't believe there is. So, God bless her. Thank you.
As I often say, I know that you will have other chances to do this, and I encourage you to spend some time remembering these wonderful moments of Betty's life. My parents have been gone, I think I was figuring out 30 years now, and my sisters and I get together, and all of a sudden, we're talking about one of those memories, and they just mean so much to us and everything, and you've got so many wonderful memories with Betty that's such a special thing. So, let us pray. God of us all, your love never ends. When all else fails, you still are God. We pray to you for one another in our need and for all anywhere who mourn with us this day. To those who doubt, give light. To those who are weak, strength. To all who have sinned, mercy. To all who sorrow, your peace. Keep true in us the love with which we hold one another. In all our ways we trust you, and to you with your church on earth and in heaven, we offer honor and glory now and forever. O God, all that you have given us is yours. As first you gave Betty to us, now we give Betty back to you. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant, Betty Walton. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive Betty into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints of light. God of love, we thank you for all with which you have blessed us even to this day. For the gift of joy and days of health and strength, and for the gifts of your abiding presence and promise in days of pain and grief. We praise you for home and friends and for our baptism and place in your church with all who have faithfully lived and died. Above all else, we thank you for Jesus, who knew our griefs, who died our death and rose for our sake, and who lives and prays for us. And as he taught us, so now we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Let's turn our hymnals to one more hymn, a favorite of Betty's. I'm sorry, go ahead, keep going. 454, Open My Eyes That I May See.
Open my eyes that I may see glimpses of truth thou hast for me. Place in my hand the wonderful key that shall unclasp and set me free. Silently now I wait for thee, ready, my God, thy will to see. Open my eyes and illumine me, Spirit divine. Open my ears that I may hear voices of truth thou sendest clear.